Hi, I'm Robert Jeffress, pastor of First Baptist Church in Dallas. We are so excited to have you join us on the iCampus today for a time of inspiring worship and biblical teaching. You are part of a vast online community gathered from all over the world. We consider you a part of our First Baptist Church family, and we hope you feel a part of what God is doing in and through First Baptist Dallas. No matter where you are, we hope and pray that this is a time you will grow in your relationship with God and others as we worship our Savior together. Welcome to worship.
Let's all stand together and join in singing.
To God be the glory, great things He has done. So loved He the world that He gave us His Son, who yielded His life and atonement for sin. Let the
Amen. Thank you for your great singing. If you're watching us on iCampus, we hope you're able to sing along as well. As we think about what our Lord has done for us on the cross, for poor sinners like us, we can only stand in amazement. Let's sing.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. Oh, 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 oh. He took my sins and my sorrows.
Love your singing this morning. You may be seated as we turn our attention to the baptismal waters.
Well, good morning, church. We have Martha Murphy here today, and Martha has traveled from South Carolina to be here to be baptized. She's had some significant issues to get here, and she's been trying to be baptized here for a year. She has watched Pastor since 2016 and considers this her church home, watches every week. So, Martha, we welcome you today. And because of your profession of faith, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in the likeness of his death, raised to walk in newness of life. Praise the Lord. Just turn around this way. I got you. Take your time. Your time. Isn't that just incredible? Our next candidate is also from out of town. She has watched on iCampus and she currently resides in Louisiana. So she's here today as our guest as well. And we are excited to be able to baptize her today. Gail, because of your profession of faith, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in the likeness of his death, raised to walk in newness of life. Good job. We have Tayo Oki next. Tayo became a Christian after listening to Pastor in 2019. He was listening to KCBI and Pastor's Pathway to Victory show. He became a Christian and moved to the Dallas area and has been at our church for 2 months and has come forward now for believer's baptism. Tayo, because of your profession of faith, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in the likeness of his death, raised to walk in newness of life. Praise the Lord, brother. We have Matthew Leonas here. Matthew became a Christian at age 8, and he's coming now before everyone for believer's baptism. We're excited for you, Matthew. Matthew, because of your profession of faith, I baptize you, my little brother, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in the likeness of his death, raised to walk in newness of life. We have Michael here. Michael Garcia III. Michael became a Christian this past December, December of 23. Michael, because of your profession of faith, I baptize you, my little brother, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in the likeness of his death, raised to walk in newness of life. Good job, Michael. And last but not least, I have the opportunity to be able to baptize my middle child, Lilla McFadden. Lilla became a Christian on January 22nd, 2024, at home. She prayed to receive Christ. Lilla, we're so proud of you. Your mother and I have prayed many prayers ever since we could rock you as a baby that this day would come. And our prayer continues that during life circumstances that the Lord's face would shine upon you and that he would give you peace no matter what. Lilla, because of your profession of faith, I baptize you, my little sister, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, buried with Christ in the likeness of his death, raised to walk in newness of life.
I'm so glad to be a part of a church where God is moving and changing lives. Amen. We're so glad you're here in worship with us today. We know there's a special blessing for you. If you're a guest with us, we have a special gift. It's our pastor's book, Not All Roads Lead to Heaven, devotional, a nugget of wisdom that you can enjoy each day and be blessed by it. To receive your free gift as a guest, all we need you to do is reach inside your worship guide and take out the guest card and fill it out, or scan the QR code there in the corner for the digital version. At the end of the service, take it out the exits to our guest center, our welcome center. Our staff is there waiting for you, and they'll exchange your completed card for your free gift. If you're watching on iCampus, we have a gift for you as well. Just click the link on your screen and you'll find out more information. It's a wonderful season of ministry at First Dallas. Let's turn our attention to the screens to find out more.
Good morning. Here are a few upcoming events. Couples, purchase your ticket for the Marriage Matters Conference on April 26th. Learn practical tools from guest speakers Steve and Debbie Wilson about improving communication, managing conflict, and meeting each other's needs. The next iteration of our spring training program launches next Sunday. For the next 5 weeks together, we'll explore the Psalms and ask God to transform our hearts. If you've made a profession of faith and have not yet followed it with believers' baptism, participate in Baptism Sunday on April 28th, presided over by Dr. Jeffress. Sign up today on the concourse. Then join us for an evening of fun and fellowship for the whole family at Spring Fest on May 5th at 4:30 p.m., featuring bounce houses, a train, lots of games, food, Frios gourmet pops, and more. Then at 6:30 p.m., the First Dallas Orchestra presents Legendary Stories, taking you through iconic moments from some of the greatest stories ever told in movies, musicals, opera, and ballet. For more information on everything happening at our church, visit firstdallas.org/events.
Hi, iCampus viewers. I'm Robert Jeffress, pastor of First Baptist Church in Dallas. If you have made a profession of faith in Jesus Christ, but haven't yet followed that decision with believer's baptism, I want to specifically invite you to come to First Baptist Dallas and participate in our Baptism Sunday on Sunday, April 28th. This is the perfect opportunity to publicly profess your faith in Christ and be baptized the way the Bible commands, by immersion after your salvation. Following the conclusion of our 11 a.m. worship service, I will be presiding over this special baptism service. And then afterwards, you'll have the chance to visit with our staff members and enjoy a special time of food and fellowship. If you'd like to participate on Sunday, April 28th, visit firstdallas.org/baptismsunday and let us know that you're part of our iCampus community. We can't wait to host you, and I'm looking forward to getting to meet you personally.
From the book of Ephesians, as the pastor continues this great series from that book called Holy Living in an Unholy World. And today we're reading from Ephesians 5 and the first five verses, reading from the New American Standard Bible. And we'll have those words on the screen here in the worship center. And also, we will have them on the screen for you on iCampus so that we can all join together in reading God's Word. And we'll ask you to stand with us. We do that to honor the reading of His Word. Ephesians chapter 5, beginning with verse 1 and ending with verse 5. Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children, and walk in love, just as Christ also loved you and gave himself up for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God as a fragrant aroma. But immorality or any impurity or greed must not even be named among you, as is proper among saints. And there must be no filthiness and silly talk or coarse jesting, which are not fitting, but rather giving of thanks. For this you know with certainty, that no immoral or impure person or covetous man who is an idolater has an inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and God. And may God richly bless the reading of His Holy Word. Let's keep standing as Dr. Joe Harden comes back. We continue our worship time together.
you so much. You may be seated. As we turn our attention to an important Mission 1-8 milestone.
As Christians, despite our flaws in this broken world, we are flawless in Christ. This was the message heard by over 1,400 women of all ages from across DFW as they gathered to worship our Lord and Savior and deepen their faith at the first Dallas Women's Conference. Among these women, 224 volunteers served faithfully in various capacities. Women lifted their voices in meaningful praise and worship, led by our First Dallas Band. Over the 2 days, ladies enjoyed 6 sessions from an incredible panel of female speakers. Plus, women engaged in various experiences out on the concourse, including an interactive prayer wall, a scripture memory, temporary tattoo station, and the opportunity to mold jars of clay. Our prayer warriors were busy at work, having one-on-one conversations, facilitating rededications, and collecting over 200 written prayer requests from women who vulnerably shared the desires of their hearts to our Lord and our team. Church family, thanks to your faithfulness to Mission 1-8 Win Now, our women's ministry is able to reach the city of Dallas and give a bold biblical vision for womanhood, affirming that in Christ, we are indeed flawed, yet flawless.
Amen. Good morning, church. Did you get that? This past weekend, over 1,000 women were gathered in this room for the First Baptist Dallas Women's Conference, Flawed Yet Flawless. What an amazing time that they had, and we're thankful for our ministry team that serves in that area. We got many wonderful stories of life change that came out of that conference. One of them was emailed into us from Maryland. She said, "The women's conference at First Baptist Dallas was gut-level teaching and heart-inspiring. Real women teaching and sharing their imperfections, hurts, disappointments, and longings." She said that one of her key takeaways is that God's word distinguishes the truth from the lies we tell ourselves. Amen. And it's not just about equipping the women of our church, but also reaching the lost. One of our women tells a story of walking up the sidewalk to come inside. When she did, she met someone. She invited that lady to come in with her. When they got to the ticket table, she said, "Now, what is your name?" The women's ministry, as well as I believe that that was a divine appointment for sure. We want to thank our incredible women's ministry team for what they do and the fact that they serve so tirelessly to create these types of events for equipping and inspiring others. But church, we also want to thank you because of your faithfulness in giving faithfully through Mission 1-8 Win Now. We're able to continue doing ministries just like that here and abroad. We thank you for your participation in that. This morning, as we continue in this time of worship and giving, I encourage you to participate in giving. We have boxes as you exit the room. You're welcome to leave your gifts and offerings in those boxes. And if you're worshiping with us online, you can go to firstdallas.org/giveonline and participate in giving that way. But as we continue and we give thanks, I invite all of you to kneel across the room as you're able. We go to the Lord in prayer to give him thanks for all that he has done and all that he's doing. Father God, we come before you today just to thank you for all that you have done, all that you are doing, and all that you're going to do. We pray, Father, that you would just move in each of our lives to give generously and faithfully, because we know that each one of those people represents a soul that needs to know you and grow closer to you. Thank you for these gifts and offerings. We pray that we're glorifying and honoring to you with all that you've given to us. And we just pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you so much, Marty Dutton, Joe Harden, and great First Dallas Choir and Orchestra for your music today. We welcome the millions of you who are watching on our iCampus and on Pathway to Victory. And speaking of Pathway to Victory, I'm glad to have two of our greatest supporters of Pathway to Victory and friends of ours, Chris and Kathy Ball, with us today. Thank you all for coming and being a part of our fellowship today. No matter how hard we try, we can't keep from becoming like our parents. Have you noticed that? That's not altogether bad. I've told you about my dad before. He was a wonderful Christian. He had many positive qualities that I certainly have tried to emulate. He was a hard worker. He was an independent thinker. He never went with the flow. But he had some idiosyncrasies that my siblings and I noticed early on that we vowed we would never repeat. And yet now, as we look at each other, we laugh because we can see our dad in one another. The culinary habits, the particular likes and dislikes, the facial expressions. We have become like our dad. In the passage we're going to look at today, Paul tells us we need to become like our father. Not our earthly father, our heavenly father. And that's the theme of the message today. Why we need to become like our father and how we do that. If you have your Bibles, turn to Ephesians chapter 5. Now, it's been several weeks since we've been in Ephesians. Let me set the context. It's important for understanding what we're going to look at today. Remember, Paul's letter to the Christians at Ephesus is divided into two parts. The first half of the book, chapters 1 to 3, is about the spiritual wealth we have from God. Think of all that God's done for you. He's chosen you, predestined you, adopted you into his family, empowered you with the Holy Spirit of God. He has given you great spiritual riches. That's chapters 1 to 3. But that ought to have some impact on how we live today. And that's chapters 4 to 6. That's about our walk with God. Not only our wealth from God, but our walk with God. Therefore, Paul says, walk in a manner worthy of the calling with which you have been called. And Ephesians 4 through 6 is how we pull that off. Paul says when it comes in relationship to other Christians, we ought to walk in unity. We talked about the importance of unity in the body of Christ. In the section we're in right now, he says in relationship to your personal behavior, walk in purity. And then later on, we'll see in a couple of weeks, when it talks about our family life, we're to walk in harmony. And finally, he says, when it comes to spiritual warfare, we're to walk in victory. We're in the section now about our personal conduct and walking in purity, and that's where we come to chapter 5, verse 1. Remember what Paul says here? He says, therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children. That Greek word imitators is mimeta in Greek, mimetai. It's a word we get, what, mimic from. You know what it is to mimic. It's to try to duplicate somebody else's speech, their mannerisms, their appearance. A mimic. A mimic is somebody who studies somebody else carefully in order to duplicate their actions and their voice. And whenever I think of a mimic, I think about our good friend Dennis Swanberg, the comedian. He does impressions of other people. I first met Dennis 40 years ago when we were in a doctoral class together at the seminary. I don't remember one thing the professor said in the class because Dennis kept us laughing the whole time with his impersonations. I was the youth minister here at the time, and we were getting ready to have a big banquet. So I asked Dennis if he would come over and be the entertainment. And I said, I want you to do all your impersonations except me. And I said, and I'd like you to do Dr. Criswell. He's going to be there. Dennis had never done Dr. Criswell before, and he said he really had only heard him a couple of times. And I said, well, I'll send you some cassette tapes. So I sent him just this huge package of cassette tapes. And Dennis listened and listened and listened and imitated and practiced. Finally came the night of the banquet, and he did his Dr. Criswell impersonation. Dr. Criswell roared with laughter. I was so relieved, but a little concerned when I suddenly got a call to Eastland, Texas to be the pastor there. I'm not sure if there was any relationship between that. But you know, that's what a mimic does. He impersonates somebody else. The Bible says we're to be imitators, mimics of God. One commentator said it this way: we are to repeat God's actions, we're to echo his speech, and we're to duplicate his behavior. How can we, finite human beings, duplicate God's behavior? How can we echo his words? How could we ever be like God? Isn't that what got Satan thrown out of heaven when he wanted to be like God? Well, when we talk about who God is, we talk about his attributes. And theologians separate his attributes, his characteristics, into two categories. The non-communicable attributes, that is, what's unique about God that can't be duplicated. God is omniscient. No matter how hard I try, I cannot be all-knowing. God is omnipotent. I can't be all-powerful. God is omnipresent. He's everywhere at once. I can only be one place at once. So there's certain things about God we could never duplicate. But then there are his communicable attributes. Things like justice and mercy and love, those are the things we are to imitate. So you've got this general command, be imitators of God. And fortunately, God has given us, when we become a Christian, the spiritual genes we need to become like God. Those spiritual genes are called the Holy Spirit of God. Paul's going to talk about him in chapter 5. But it's through the Holy Spirit's effort in our life and our effort combined that we can become imitators of God. Now, Paul's going to get real specific in this section. He said, here are three characteristics of God you're to seek to duplicate. In verse 2, he says, we are to walk in love. Secondly, we are to walk, verse 8, in light. And finally, verse 15, we're to walk in wisdom. If you want to be like God, walk in love, light, and wisdom. Now, let's look at that in more concentrated. First of all, the command to walk in love. Look at it in Ephesians. Actually, it begins in verse 32 of chapter 4. Remember, there were no chapter divisions in the original text. This is one long letter. And so this thought actually begins in chapter 4, verse 32. Be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving each other, just as God in Christ. Underline that, just as God. Just as God in Christ has also forgiven you. Therefore, and this is chapter 5, verse 1, be imitators of God as beloved children and walk in love, here it is again, just as Christ, underline that, has loved you and has given himself up for us as an offering and sacrifice to God as a fragrant aroma. What I want you to see is when Paul says we're to love one another, he's not talking about some syrupy emotion that's hard to define. He's talking about a very specific kind of love, a love that forgives. That's one of God's attributes. He is a forgiver. Somebody has said we are never more like beasts when we devour one another, and we are never more like God when we forgive one another. We ought to forgive just as God in Christ has forgiven us. Now, that's easier said than done, isn't it? C.S. Lewis said, forgiveness is a beautiful word until you have somebody to forgive. Then it becomes not so pleasant. I mean, why should you forgive people who hurt you and wrong you? How do you forgive terrible acts that have no explanation to them? I remember one night in 2015, Amy and I were having dinner at Maggiano's. I guess she was having dinner with the pastor, but that's but we were having dinner together, and my telephone rang, and it was Fox News in New York. They said, we need you to get to a studio as quickly as possible. There's been a horrific act in Charleston, South Carolina. A gunman entered a Wednesday night prayer meeting at the Emmanuel Church and killed 9 African Americans. How do you explain that? You remember a few days after that, the suspect in the killing was forced to face the families, the victims' families of those who had been slain. Mothers, fathers, siblings all talked about the pain they experienced. And one by one, they looked at that suspect and they recounted what had happened to them as a result of his murderous act. But then they added the words, "But we forgive you." And one family after another said, "We forgive you. We forgive you. We forgive you." You know, it's one thing to forgive somebody for not smiling at you or saying hello. It's altogether different when somebody inflicts irreparable harm upon your life. How do you forgive? Well, the key is in this section. We're to forgive just as God in Christ has forgiven us. We're to forgive just as Christ also loved us. You'll never be able to forgive others until you understand the great debt from which God has forgiven you. I know, I've talked about it 100,000 times. But remember that parable in Matthew 18 Jesus told to illustrate why we should forgive? It was about a king who had a servant that owed him 10,000 talents of gold. A talent was 70 or 80 pounds. Do the math, it's about $16 billion in today's currency. Here's a slave who owed the master $16 billion. And the master said, "I want my money." The slave said, "I have no way to pay back that debt. Please be patient with me and I will repay you everything." Well, there's no way he could repay that debt. And the Bible says that hardened king looked on that poor slave and had compassion on him. And he forgave him. He released him of that debt. Unbelievable. That slave who had been forgiven $16 billion goes out, Jesus said, and found a fellow slave who owed him $16. He grabbed him by the throat and said, "Repay me everything you owe me." The second slave said, "I don't have the money to repay you, but please be patient with me. And remember what the first slave said? "No, I'm not going to have any patience with you. I'm going to throw you into prison until you repay everything." And when the king heard about what that first slave of his had done, he had him brought back to him and he said, "You wicked slave, how could you refuse to forgive such a little debt when you have been forgiven such a large debt?" And the king threw that first slave into prison and over to the torturers until he should repay everything. And then Jesus added the zinger in the last verse. He said, "So shall my heavenly Father do to each of you if you do not forgive your neighbor from your heart." Listen to me. Jesus isn't denying that you've been hurt by another person. He's not diminishing that hurt. He said, just keep that hurt in perspective. Because the difference between how much somebody has helped hurt you and how much you have hurt and offended God is the difference between $16 and $16 billion. Forgiveness is the obligation of those who have been forgiven. Notice what he said in verse 2 of chapter 5. "Walk in love just as Christ also loved you, gave himself up for us as an offering and a sacrifice to God as a fragrant aroma." That's a reference to the Old Testament sacrifices. There was nothing fragrant about burning an animal. The smell was anything but fragrant. But to God, it was fragrant because it resulted in forgiveness. In the same way, God did not delight in the death, the torture, the crucifixion of his own son, but he delighted in the result. And the result of Christ's death for us was the forgiveness of our sins. If you want to be like God, then you walk in love. That means forgiving other people. But he also talks about a second way we imitate God, and that is by walking in light. Look at verses 8 through 10. "For you were formerly darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light, for the fruit of the light consists in all goodness and righteousness and truth, trying to learn what is pleasing to the Lord." The Bible says God is light. He's pure. He's holy. He is righteous. And we are to imitate that in our life and not walk in darkness. Think about how much God loves light. Do you know what his first words recorded in Scripture were? What is the first thing God said? Let there be light. God is light. John talks about that in 1 John 1, verses 5 through 7. This is the message we have heard from him and announced to you, that God is light and in him there is no darkness at all. If we say we have fellowship with him and yet walk in the darkness, we do not practice the truth. Earlier in chapter 4 of Ephesians, Paul talked about people who were darkened in their understanding because of the foolishness that is within them, because of the hardness of their hearts. He was talking about the way Gentiles live in immorality and murder and covetousness. He said they do that because they've hardened their heart through the truth. But we're not to be like that. We're to be children of light. Well, how do we pull that off? How do we walk in the light? Well, first of all, we have to understand what darkness is. And notice his description of walking in darkness in verses 3 to 4. He says, but immorality or any impurity or greed must not be named among you as is proper among the saints. And there must be no filthiness and silly talk or coarse jesting, which are not fitting, but rather the giving of thanks. This is a list of dark deeds. It's not a complete list, but it's some that were especially meaningful to the Ephesians because of what was going on in the Temple of Diana. He said, first of all, you put aside immorality. The Greek word there is porneia. It is the word we get pornography from. It's an umbrella term that really covers all sexual immorality. Immorality, porneia. Remember, God is the one who created sex. It was God's gift to us. But there's only one restriction God put on sex. Only one. Not 10, not 5, not 100, but one. And that one restriction is no sex outside of marriage. Other than that, you're free to do whatever you and your partner want to do, but there's just no sex outside marriage. And yet people naturally rebel against that. All immorality is a violation of that one restriction. God gave that restriction not to restrict our happiness, but to enhance it. He made us. He knows how sex best operates, and it best operates in the marriage relationship. Every time I use this illustration, somebody and the media will pick it up and use it as something to ridicule, but it's still a good illustration. Just imagine you go to Best Buy and you get a 60-inch television set, and you're so excited you come home, mount it on your wall, and you plug it in. Now, there's a little owner's guide that tells you how to operate the set, and the owner's guide says you're to plug it into a 120 outlet and only a 120 outlet. But suppose you read that and you say, you know, that's a little restrictive. This is my TV set. I bought it. I can do whatever I want to with it. I'm going to plug it into a 220 outlet. What happens if you do that? You blow up the set. That manufacturer gave that restriction not for his benefit, but for yours. And it's the same way with sex. God says no sex outside of marriage. By the way, did you know sociologists now have studies that show couples that live together before marriage are much more likely to divorce than those who wait for sex until they are married? That's just an example of how God knows what is best. We're to put aside immorality. Then secondly, he says put aside impurity. This word means uncleanness. It literally refers to the foul smell that comes from an open wound. That's what impurity is. Probably Paul has in mind here some particular sexual perversions that were common in the Temple of Diana: homosexuality, pedophilia, prostitution. Put that aside, that's darkness. Thirdly, he says, put aside greed. We're to avoid greed. Now, at first, that seems misplaced. We've been talking about sex. Why does he talk about money? Because greed and immorality come from the same base emotion, and that's covetousness. Wanting something more or something different than what God has provided for us. God hasn't given me enough money. I need more in order to be truly happy. God hasn't given me the right mate. I need someone else to fulfill me. That's all covetousness. And by the way, unless you think I'm making this connection up, that's what Paul says in Ephesians 5:5. He said, "Know this with all certainty, that no immoral or impure person or covetous man who is an idolater has any inheritance in the kingdom of God." You know where the heart of idolatry is? It's believing if I had something more or different, I could truly be happy. It's looking to things or people to fill a void in our life, to become an idol in our life, a void that only God can fill. He says, "Fourth, put aside filthiness." That's darkness. This refers to obscene or shameless speech. In fact, in verse 12, he's going to say, it's disgraceful even to speak of the things which are done in secret. I have a friend who a long time ago was reading a men's book, a Christian book, on avoiding temptation. He said, there were such graphic descriptions in the first chapter that I just threw the book away. It was talking about things I didn't want staying around in my mind. That's what the Bible says. It's a shame to speak of those things which are done in darkness. Bible teacher Warren Wiersbe said, people who have base appetites usually cultivate a base kind of speech and humor. And when people who want to commit sexual sins or have committed them, they enjoy jesting about them. Fifth, he says, avoid silly talk. No, that word silly literally means in Greek, moronic. Talking like a moron, just silly talk. We're to avoid that. Finally, he said, darkness includes coarse jesting. Now, it doesn't just say jesting. There's nothing wrong with being funny and enjoying a joke. In fact, Ecclesiastes 3:1 says, there is a time for everything under heaven, including a time to laugh. Proverbs 17:22 says, a joyful heart is good. It's good. It's good medicine. But the word coarse here literally means a well-turned wit, a well-turned word. Coarseness is turning something clean into something that's dirty. We call it in our culture innuendo. Everything is dirty. Everything has a dirty connotation to it. Double entendre. We think it is so clever for people to take something clean and pervert it. God doesn't think it's humorous at all. It's coarse. Just think of late night talk show hosts and how they'll take things and turn them into something dirty. In my day, it was Johnny Carson. He was a master comedian, but he also had a way of just turning things into something that was unclean. Somebody said the distance between talking about immorality and committing immorality is a shorter distance than you can possibly imagine. Don't let these things become a part of your speech. Instead, be known for giving thanks. John R. Stott, the late pastor, said, all of God's gifts, including sex, are subjects for thanksgiving rather than for joking. To joke about them is to degrade them. To thank God for them is a way to preserve their worth as a blessing of our Creator. Now, that's a description of walking in darkness. Now, Paul is going to give a defense for walking in light instead. Why should we choose to walk in light, holiness, righteousness, instead of darkness? Notice the two reasons Paul gives. First of all, he says, because we are recipients of God's light. Look at verse 6. Let nobody deceive you with empty words, for because of these things, the immorality, the impurity, the uncleanness, because of these things, the wrath of God comes upon the sons of disobedience. Therefore, do not be partakers with them, for you were formerly darkness. You used to operate in darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. We're to walk in light because God has shown his light on us. You know, while I was reading that this week, I thought about Amy and I when we were dating in high school. We would go out on a date or maybe to a movie or to eat, and then we would come back to Amy's house, and we'd go into the living room and would be seated on the couch, and would enjoy a little bit of fellowship together. You know what I'm talking about. Nothing immoral, just a little fellowship, a holy kiss or two. But Amy's father, who, by the way, is still with us at age 96 and watching this broadcast right now, Amy's father had the most annoying habit. He had the ability to move around quietly like a cat burglar. You never knew where he was. You could never find him. And suddenly, we'd be enjoying our fellowship time when the lights would turn on. Just about give me a heart attack. And there he would be standing, just checking in. Do you think turning on that light had any effect on my behavior? You better believe it did. Light is a motivation to do the right thing. And we need to remember the light is shining on us right now, whether we realize it or not. I remember, think about being a teenager, we used to have these Bible teachers who would say, now before you go out parking on Friday night, just ask yourself this question, what if Jesus were to come back and see what you were doing? What would he think about it? Now, the only problem with that is, where is Jesus right now? Is he in heaven with blinders on and can't see anything? He's watching right now. It's not just some future day. He's watching, evaluating, and judging. The light is shining on us. Therefore, we ought to walk in the light. We're the recipients of God's light. But not only that, secondly, we are the reflectors of God's light. We're like the moon. The moon doesn't generate its own light. It reflects the light of the sun. And so we are to reflect, not block. We are to reflect the light that comes from God the Father. And that's what he's talking about in verse 11 through 13. Do not participate in the unfruitful deeds of darkness, but instead expose them. We are God's floodlight to expose wickedness. Now, you know, sometimes non-Christians are repelled by that. Have you ever heard a non-Christian say, oh, I don't like hanging around Christians. They're so judgmental. Well, they may never say anything, but that unbeliever is convicted of the way he's living by the way that they live and obey God. And so they're repelled from the light. But there are other unbelievers who are attracted to God by the way they see Christians walking in the light. Albert Schweitzer had a great word about influence. He said, example is not the main thing in influencing people. It's the only thing. The way we reflect God is through our behavior, by walking in the light. And that's why Jesus said in Matthew 5, let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven. We are to walk in the light because we are recipients of the light and we are to be reflectors of God's light. I have a story in my file, and I don't know, I got it years ago, and I honestly don't know where it came from. So whomever I stole that from listening right now, my apologies. But it's a great story. It's a summary of an episode from the old Alfred Hitchcock show. Some of you remember Alfred Hitchcock? He was the master of suspense. When I was a little boy, one thing I did with my dad was every week we would watch the Alfred Hitchcock show together. And each week it was an anthology. There was some new story, some creepy, eerie story. And in 1964, there was an episode called The Final Escape. It was about a woman who was convicted of murder. She was sentenced to life in prison. And she was so angry, she yelled at the judge and said, this is unfair, and I will find a way to get out of this prison. So she's taken to prison. While she's there, she befriends an old man who works in the prison. His job is to build the caskets for anyone who dies. And he needed cataract surgery, so she said, I will give you the money if you'll help me escape from this prison. And what the old man would do was, whenever somebody would die, he would place their body in the newly made casket wheel the casket outside the wall of the prison and bury it in the cemetery. So she had this idea. She said, the next time somebody dies, I'm going to get into the casket. You'll wheel me out, bury me in the casket, and then the next day when nobody's looking, come back and rescue me. What could go wrong with that plan? So a couple of days later in the TV show, the bell begins to toll, signaling a prisoner has died. And this woman gets out of bed, makes her way down to the little room where they make the caskets. It's dark. She climbs into the casket in complete darkness, pulls the lid in the casket, pulls it down. She waits, and she can start to feel the wheels turning as the casket makes its way outside the prison and outside the gate. She can feel as it's lifted up and it's put into the ground. She can hear the clumps of dirt being thrown onto the casket. She smiles. Her escape is complete. She waits and waits. The next morning comes. Nothing happens. The morning turns into another nighttime, and she begins to panic. Something's wrong. She takes a match, and she lights it and sees that the corpse she's with is the body of the old man who made the caskets. And the last scene of the show is the camera tilting up from the cemetery to the sky as you hear the woman wailing uncontrollably, realizing she will be in that grave forever. I told that story one time in a church service on Easter Sunday. And a man wrote me the letter the next week, said, that is the worst story I have ever heard. I am never coming back to church again. It is a creepy story. It's an eerie story, but I'll tell you something even more eerie, and that is Christians who have been raised to a whole new way of living, to walk in the light, who voluntarily choose to climb back into that casket of sin, death, darkness, judgment, and live there forever. What a poor choice. That's why verse 14 closes with these words, arise, O sleeper, verse 14, and arise from the dead, for Christ will shine on you. Walking in the light instead of the darkness. Let's bow together in a word of prayer. We're going to do something different today. I'm going to ask everybody to stand with heads bowed and eyes closed. Our altar partners are coming to the front today. There may be some of you who your greatest need right now is to receive the forgiveness Jesus Christ offers you for the forgiveness of your sins. You'll never be able to forgive others until you've received that forgiveness. That's why Christ came, to die for your sins. But I also realize most of us here today are already believers. Now with every head bowed, every eye closed, maybe as you've listened to this message, God has brought to you, to your mind, somebody you need to forgive. We're never more like God than when we choose to forgive. Maybe there's somebody you need to forgive, not because they deserve to be forgiven, not because they've asked to be forgiven, but you need to forgive them so that you can be free to get on with the life God has for you. And the reason we forgive is because of the great forgiveness God has extended to us. For some of you, today is that day to make that decision, to let go, to say, God, I'm going to let you deal with this person, but I'm not going to hold on to that offense. I'm not going to let it define the rest of my life. Today, I'm choosing to forgive because I've been forgiven. There are others of you today, maybe, who, as we talk about walking in the light, you realize there's some dark areas of your life that need to be dealt with. Maybe an addiction, maybe a relationship, maybe a habit, maybe something you're not doing that you know you need to start doing, but God has spoken to you. That's the Holy Spirit convicting you. God's given you the power, but you have to supply the desire. And maybe today you'd like to come to one of these altar partners and just say, pray with me as I try to walk in the light. You don't have to share any details. Just have somebody pray with you. Maybe there's some of you here today who have a real need in your life. It could be for physical healing. Doctors don't have an answer maybe for what you're experiencing, or maybe there seems to be little hope for healing. We have not because we ask not. It's not always God's desire to heal us, but sometimes it is. Maybe today you'd like to come and ask God to heal you from a particular problem you're facing right now, or the problem a loved one is facing. Maybe you have a financial need. Maybe the need for a reconciled relationship that's been broken. Maybe you have a child or grandchild who's living apart from God. You know, God says, where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am in their midst. There's something powerful about praying in agreement with another Christian. That's why we have our altar partners here. These are godly men and women who will pray with you. So today, if you have any need at all in your life or the life of somebody you care about, I invite you to come right now as our choir begins to sing. You come.
Just as I am without one pain.
That's right. Be sensitive to those who are trying to move out of the pews. Thank you. Plenty of time to come. You come. There's time if you're in the balcony to come.
Of God I come.
Maybe you realize today that your need for God is not partial, it's total, and you need God to do a miracle in your life. What a shame it would be to leave here without asking God in the power of prayer with another Christian to answer that need that you have. We still have time for you to come. That's right, people from the balcony are coming. You have time to come. Just going to sing a stanza or two more. There's still time for you to come. Now, when our altar partners are finished praying, they can return to their seats. I know we have a few more that are praying right now. It's a beautiful thing to see Christians praying with one another. So thank you for praying. Again, our altar partners can return to their seats. And as they finish their prayer time, let me just remind you, first of all, if you are a guest today, I'd love to have the chance to meet you and give you a copy of my new book, Not All Roads Lead to Heaven, Daily Devotional. All you have to do is just fill out the card and come to the Welcome Center. I'll be there to greet all of our guests. If you prayed the prayer to trust in Christ as Savior today, check that box. If you'd like to join our church, you can check that box as well. Speaking of dinner with the pastor, we had that Thursday night, a great crowd at Maggiano's. 30 people joined our church Thursday night. And we welcome them into our fellowship and more to come. But if you'd like to join, you can check that box and bring the card with you to the Welcome Center. Final thing, this Wednesday night, something historic in our church. We're having the first ever commissioning service for women who have been called to ministry. We're very clear. Only men are to serve as senior pastors, but there are a variety of ministries for women in our church. And we're going to have 12 of our female staff members who are going to be commissioned. They feel called to ministry. They're going to share their testimony, and you'll want to come and rejoice in that. 6:30 in Truett Chapel. Well, it's been a good day to be in God's house. Thank you for being here today. Don't forget our children's musical this afternoon at 4 o'clock in Center Stage. Dr. Harden, thank you for doing a great job of filling in for Tyler and what you do with our orchestra every week. Come and lead us in our final song.
Let's join in singing.
This is my story.
Have a blessed day.
Hello, I'm Emmanuel Pandula, but you can call me Manny, your iCampus pastor. Thanks for joining us for worship. I hope you feel uplifted and encouraged after today's service. Continue to spread the joy by inviting your loved ones to join us every week and stay connected on our social media platforms and iCampus Global Facebook group, where you'll find inspiring content, updates, and connect with believers worldwide. Also, join our iCampus community for a Sunday school lesson taught by Ryland Whitehorn, our executive pastor of ministries at 8:30, 9:15, and 11 a.m. Central Time. I look forward to personally getting to know you. So be sure to leave a message in the chat about how I can pray and minister to you. Remember, we're here to serve you every Sunday morning and throughout the week in your spiritual walk. Stay blessed and see you soon.